The Psychology of Driving by Graham Hole, read by Keith Warmington. Preface. There is a disease that kills roughly 1.25 million people every year and causes harm to around 50 million more, often leaving them with life-changing disabilities. It's the ninth most common cause of death in the world, and it's the leading cause of death for 15 to 29-year-olds. And the really sad thing is that it's largely preventable. Since you're listening to this book, you've probably guessed what this disease is: road accidents. These statistics come from the World Health Organization's Global Status Report on Road Safety 2015. Great Britain is one of the safest countries in the world for driving. Only Norway and Sweden are safer. Even so, in 2016, the Department for Transport reports that there were 1,792 deaths on the road in Britain, 24,101 serious accidents, and perhaps as many as 700,000 accidents in total. That's 5 deaths on the roads every day. Psychology is relevant to all this, because the vast majority of road accidents are due to human error, not mechanical failure. Drivers crash for many reasons. They fail to see each other. They take risks, such as overtaking in silly places, or driving too fast for the conditions. And they drive while affected by alcohol, drugs, lack of sleep, or while they are distracted by their phones. Sometimes they crash because they get angry or frustrated with one another. A minority of elderly drivers crash because they can no longer cope with the mental and physical demands of driving. Perception, attention, fatigue, aggression, risk perception, aging, and so on are all issues that have been studied extensively by psychologists, often for many decades. Psychologists know an awful lot that is relevant to understanding how humans manage to drive and why sometimes they fail. This book can only be a brief introduction to psychological research that is relevant to driving. There are literally thousands of research papers on each of the topics covered in this book. My emphasis will be on cognitive psychology, specifically perception and attention, partly as a reflection of my own background, but also because we are very visual animals and driving is a very visual business. However, social psychologists also play a very important role in understanding how and why we drive like we do. Social psychology deals with topics such as attitude formation, attitude change, and risk perception. And knowledge of these topics is essential for understanding why drivers take risks and how they can be persuaded to drive more safely. This book is intended for anyone who has an interest in driving, and I hope there is something here for everyone. Driving is a topic that many people have strong opinions about, but opinions are not necessarily based on good evidence. Psychology is a science. It uses the scientific method to investigate issues. Psychologists are trained to obtain and assess evidence as objectively as they can. Intuitive plausibility has no place in psychology. The topic of driving abounds with claims that seem plausible, such as car drivers pull out on motorcyclists at junctions because motorcycles are hard to see. Old drivers are involved in more accidents because their eyesight is bad. And mobile telephones are safe as long as the driver has both hands on the driving wheel. As we shall see, there is little evidence for any of these statements. In each case, the truth is more complicated and more interesting. If psychology is so relevant to driving, why do non-psychologists know so little about it? Part of the problem is that although there is a huge scientific literature on driving and related topics, much of it is rather inaccessible to the non-specialist because of the jargon and statistics used. Hence my intention in the following pages is to use as little jargon as possible while at the same time trying to avoid oversimplifying or trivializing the arguments. It is my firm belief that anything, no matter how complicated, can be explained if one takes enough time and trouble. I sincerely hope I have succeeded in this. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the following people for their help with this book: Kevin Phillips, Ewan Phillips, Sarah Lawrence, Jess Marshall, and Neville Stanton. Chapter 1: Perception and Attention in Driving. Introduction. Visual perception is clearly very important for driving. Try driving for any length of time with your eyes shut, and you'll see what I mean. Many accidents seem to involve perceptual errors. Every year in the UK, a contributory factor in about 45% of reported road accidents is that a driver or rider failed to look properly. The second most common factor, accounting for a further 25% of accidents, is driver or rider failed to judge another person's path or speed. In many collisions, at least one of the drivers claimed that he or she failed to see the other vehicle beforehand. The victims of these looked but failed to see accidents are often cyclists and motorcyclists. Often it's suggested that these accidents, especially the ones involving two-wheelers, are due to limitations in people's eyesight, in the sense of the sharpness of vision that's measured by an eye chart. Sometimes it's claimed that they are due to the visual system's deficiencies, such as the fact that our retinal image is poor, or because we are blind during eye movements. If you actually understand how the visual system works, you realise that none of these claims is true. Any problems really lie in the driver's brain, not the eyeballs. To explain what I mean by this, I need to tell you a bit about the visual system and what it's designed to do. Visual perception is really difficult. While you are driving, your brain rapidly and apparently effortlessly builds up an impression of a stable, richly detailed 3D world from a constantly changing array of shapes and edges. Your brain decides which contours belong together as objects, even when one object is partially obscured by another, such as a pedestrian peeking out from behind a bus. It distinguishes between different kinds of movement: movement produced by your vehicle, by that pedestrian, and by your eyes rapidly moving from looking in the mirror to scanning the road ahead. To achieve this feat, a phenomenal amount of information processing goes on behind the scenes. The eye is not a camera. It is just part of a set of neural systems that use light reflected from objects in order to acquire important information about the world. Each eye produces an upside-down, yes, really, dim, blurry, and shaky retinal image about the size of a postage stamp. No one is looking at that image. It's just the starting point for the processes underlying visual perception. The eye transmits information to the brain in the form of patterns of electrical impulses which the brain then interprets. Our subjective impressions give us a very false idea of how our perceptual processes actually operate. Notice the intermittent darkness produced by the dozen or so blinks that you make while reading a page of text, or the way your eyes move jerkily along each sentence. In change blindness demonstrations, observers have to spot the difference between two images that are displayed alternately. It is surprisingly difficult to find even quite major differences unless you are looking directly at the change as it happens. The change blindness technique simulates what happens every time you move your eyes. Your brain discards most of the information obtained from where you were looking previously, retaining only the gist of the scene. Everywhere you look, the scene appears highly detailed, but this is what Ronald Rensink and others have called the grand illusion of visual consciousness. You're unaware that where you looked previously is represented only very coarsely by the brain because you are not looking there now. The brain is faced with a huge problem. For visual information to be of any use, it has to be interpreted very rapidly, but there is a vast amount of information in any scene. Therefore, the brain needs to be very selective. It is optimized for detecting change of some kind. Changes in space or time have biological relevance. Constant states do not. It is the abrupt change produced by the edge of a cliff that you need to worry about, not the flat expanse of grassland leading up to it. At all levels, from the retina up to the higher brain regions, the visual system is beautifully designed for efficient information acquisition. Firstly, only a very small part of the scene in front of you is analysed in any detail. Fine detail vision is confined to a central region of each retina called the fovea. Beyond this tiny region, just 1.5 millimetres in diameter, acuity, sharpness of vision, becomes progressively poorer, so that in our extreme peripheral vision, we can perceive little more than a vague sensation of movement. The lack of acuity in peripheral vision is not a problem in practice because when we look at anything, eye movements ensure that its image falls upon the fovea. Normal vision consists of brief fixations, about 3 per second, linked by eye movements, mainly rapid, large-scale movements called saccades. A shift of fixation occurs either because something attracts our attention or on the basis of our knowledge and expectations about where it would be useful to look next. More on this later. This is a brilliantly elegant way to solve the problem of information overload. We don't need to store the entire outside world in our heads. We just sample information from the world as and when we need it, by moving our eyes to where that information might be located. Another way in which the brain copes with information overload is by processing visual information within only a restricted range of what is potentially available. Any scene contains information at different levels of detail. These are reflected in the spatial frequency content of the image. How often a pattern changes from light to dark as one moves across it in any particular direction. High spatial frequencies contain information about fine detail in an image, such as the contours produced by the leaves on a tree. Low spatial frequencies carry information about larger scale changes in an image, such as the gross difference between a tree and its background. Different tasks may require analysis at different spatial scales. For many driving-related tasks, such as rapid scene analysis, lane guidance, and collision avoidance, we don't actually need fine detail or high spatial frequency information. Fairly coarse, medium to low frequency information will suffice. You might be wondering how I can argue that eyesight limitations are not the cause of accidents when I've spent so much time describing the visual system's limitations. That's because these deficiencies are only a problem if you are locked into the misconception that vision somehow consists of us seeing our retinal image. The retinal image might be fairly rubbish, but seeing is not. Here's an illustration of how much processing goes on and what it can achieve. Each eye contains 127 million light-sensitive cells, photoreceptors. 7 million of these are cones, providing your fine detail colour vision in daylight. The rest are rods, providing you with coarser, monochromatic vision in twilight conditions. Your sharpest vision is primarily based on just 200,000 cones in the very centre of each fovea. However, the resolution of the visual system is far better than you would expect on the basis of the size of the photoreceptors themselves. The smallest detectable misalignment between two vertical lines is a tenth of the diameter of the smallest cone in this region. And you can see an offset this small, even when the lines are moving across the retina. Instances of visual hyperacuity like this demonstrate how much processing is going on in the brain. Electrical impulses from the retina are only the starting point in a set of processes designed to extract useful information about the world. The role of hypotheses and schemas in visual perception. Human information processing seems to rely heavily on schemas. These are generalizations that are abstracted from a number of specific instances of an activity. Schemas can operate at different levels. At a low level, there may be schemas for actions such as emerging from a junction, stopping at traffic lights, changing lanes, and so on. Activities that a driver has performed many thousands of times, even though each occasion differs in its details. At a higher level, there may be schemas for regular journeys, such as going from the house to the supermarket or picking up the children from school. Again, highly repetitive events which usually differ only in the details from one instance to another. Schemas enable us to predict what is likely to happen and respond efficiently as a result. Given that driving is such a predictable and repetitive activity most of the time, schemas and the expectations that they generate probably play an important role in determining drivers' behaviour. The existence of perceptual schemas is supported by recent work on predictive coding. For some years, the dominant view has been that perceptual processing progresses solely from lower to higher brain regions. The idea is that it starts with an analysis of elementary perceptual properties, such as detecting edges. Higher regions then integrate these into more abstract representations of objects. Finally, these representations are linked to conceptual knowledge about the objects and their significance to the viewer. However, recent neurophysiological research shows that information also flows in the opposite direction, down from high-level to low-level areas. Higher areas may actively test competing hypotheses about what incoming information represents, modulating the activity of the lower areas in order to maximize the amount of information coming up that would enable a choice to be made between these alternative hypotheses. In short, the brain uses its knowledge about the world in order to interpret sensory data. Most of the time, this is a very efficient strategy, as long as the hypotheses are appropriate. Let's return to the accident data at the start of this chapter. As I mentioned, many accidents are collisions at junctions. For example, a driver pulls out from a side road into the path of an oncoming vehicle that has the right of way. The offending driver often claims to have looked in the appropriate direction but failed to see the other vehicle. Why do these looked but failed to see LBFS accidents occur? The most obvious explanation is that the oncoming vehicle was hard to see in sensory terms. This view appears to be supported by the fact that motorcyclists and cyclists are often the victims in this type of accident. It's argued that two-wheelers are small and hence difficult to see, and so it's understandable that a driver might fail to detect them while trying to emerge from a junction. A closer look at the evidence suggests that the LBFS accidents are not caused by limitations of the offending driver's low-level visual system. Instead, they are due to failures of the more cognitive systems involved in attention, which are affected by the driver's expectations about what he or she is likely to see. You can often understand how something works by seeing how it goes wrong. By looking at LBFS accidents more closely, we can gain some insight into how perception normally works during driving. Two factors that affect attention. Because we possess fine detail vision only in a small part of our visual field, we have to direct our attention to various parts of our surroundings in turn, rather than trying to perceive the entire scene at once. There are two main influences on this process. Attention can be captured automatically and involuntarily by external stimuli, such as a sudden movement or noise. Attention can also be influenced by internal cues. It can be goal-driven or directed to something voluntarily and consciously. This distinction between two types of determinant of attention is mirrored in discussions of visibility, or conspicuity, as it's usually referred to by researchers. Something with high sensory conspicuity, such as a bright object against a dark background, attracts attention, even though the observer is not specifically looking for it. Cognitive conspicuity relates to the capacity of an object to be detected if the observer is actively searching for it. This latter type of conspicuity depends on the observer's psychological state as well as the properties of the object itself. Sensory conspicuity is based more on data-driven, bottom-up processing. Cognitive conspicuity relies more on conceptually driven, top-down processing. The two types of conspicuity need not coincide. For example, road signs giving route information are designed to have high sensory conspicuity. They are large, bright, and positioned to be easily seen. Well, usually. For a driver who needs to know that route information, the sign might also possess cognitive conspicuity. The driver is actively looking for that particular information. For a driver who knows the route well, the sign is irrelevant, and so it might not even be noticed, despite its sensory conspicuity. As well as the nature of the stimuli that attract attention, another aspect of attention that needs to be considered is its breadth. Subjectively, we feel we can vary the distribution of our attention, from covering a wide area to being tightly focused. A popular model of attention has been the zoom lens model. This suggests that attention is like a searchlight ranging over a scene, and that the breadth of the beam can be varied from narrow to wide. Another popular idea is that under stress, attention shrinks towards the point of fixation, a sort of cognitive tunnel vision. This implies that the further something is from the point of fixation, the less likely it is to be noticed. What do drivers look at? One way to try to find out what drivers are attending to is to record their eye movements. This method assumes that what a driver is looking at is what he or she is attending to. As we shall see, there is a lot of evidence that this is not always the case, but eye tracking gives us a rough idea of how drivers allocate their attention. Studies by Ronald Morant and Thomas Rockwell in the 1970s found interesting differences in drivers' eye movements as a result of experience. Compared to experienced drivers, novice drivers tended to search a smaller part of the scene, closer to the car. They tended to have a narrower horizontal search pattern, and they generally made less use of their mirrors. Novices' fixations tended to be longer than those of experienced drivers, and they made more pursuit-tracking eye movements, i.e., followed objects with their eyes. Novices also seemed less able to use information from their peripheral vision in order to steer the vehicle. More recently, Jeffrey Underwood and his colleagues at Nottingham University have performed a large number of studies comparing the fixation patterns of novice and experienced drivers, both in the laboratory and in real-life driving conditions. Their findings extend Morant and Rockwell's, additionally showing that novices and experienced drivers behave differently on different types of road. Experienced drivers generally have a broader sweep of attention, but they vary the width of their search depending on the circumstances. They have a wider spread of fixations on dual carriageways, both horizontally and vertically, than on other types of road. Their fixation durations are shorter on demanding roads, possibly so that they can sample more of the scene. Novices show little variation in their fixation behaviour, regardless of the difficulty of the road being driven. A study by Shinoda, Hayhoe, and Srivastava provides a good illustration of how experienced drivers actively sample their visual environment in order to obtain information as and when it is actually needed. Information that is directly relevant to the task is acquired, and irrelevant information is ignored. Participants drove round a computer-generated town in a driving simulator. Occasionally, a no-parking sign briefly turned into a stop sign. Detection of the change depended on the driver's knowledge of where stop signs are normally located and their knowledge of when they should be looking for it. For example, they were much less likely to notice that the sign had changed when it was located mid-block than when it was located just before a junction. Eye movement recording studies demonstrate that fixation patterns are determined by an interplay of both external, bottom-up, and internal, top-down, factors. Drivers' fixation patterns and, by implication, their allocation of attention depend a lot on past experience. Drivers usually know where to look, and what to look for, and when to look for it. Top-down control of attentional allocation like this is highly efficient, but it also carries a penalty. A strategy of looking for what you expect to find may mean you sometimes overlook what is actually there. As the psychologist Richard Gregory once put it, we not only believe what we see, but we see what we believe. Motorcycle conspicuity. About 75% of motorcycle accidents involve collision with another road user. In many of these collisions, a vehicle emerged from a junction or turned across the motorcyclist's path. When the offending drivers are asked why they failed to give way, they often say they looked but failed to see the motorcyclist. These kinds of statements have been taken at face value by many researchers because it seems common sense that motorcycles are hard to see. The fundamental problem must be that the small size of motorcycles makes it difficult for the visual system to detect them. This has led to lots of research into ways to improve motorcyclists' sensory conspicuity to other road users, generally by using daytime headlights or fluorescent clothing to make the motorcycle brighter. However, a truly scientific approach to this issue reveals that this line of thinking is fallacious. let's consider the evidence step by step. 1. What do drivers really mean when they say they failed to see the motorcycle? When a driver says, "I looked, but I didn't see the motorcyclists," it has often been taken to mean that the motorcycle could not be seen. However, this is an interpretation that goes beyond what the driver is actually saying. All we really know for certain is that the driver claimed to have looked in the direction of the oncoming motorcyclist, but for some unspecified reason was not aware of the motorcyclist's presence. In science, it's always important to distinguish between the actual data that you have and the theoretical interpretation of those data. But many researchers on this topic have confused the two. The conventional interpretation of the driver's statement about what happened is just that. It's an interpretation produced because the researcher has already made the assumption that motorcyclists are physically difficult to detect. 2. Are motorcycles really hard to see? It's true that, placed at the same distance from the viewer, motorcycles...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.